There's a privacy campaigner who's written some very good articles on this called Casper Bowden. And one of the things I've learned from reading his articles is that interception is no longer a useful concept if the NSA and GCHQ have back doors into all the services we use. And cryptography is no longer a useful defense because if they can tap right into the stream of data when it's in the clear. And these are things that I certainly thought in the early 90s that we could actually rely on. So with that said, Paul Johnson, who is the deputy editor of The Guardian, is going to start by talking about the story and how it developed, and take it away.
Glenn Greenwald was contracted to us as a blogger and, of course, was very, very intrigued and excited by what the conversations he was having with Edward Snowden. So he went out to Hong Kong to meet Snowden. But we needed to verify this stuff. We needed to verify Snowden in particular. So we sent one of our longest-serving reporters, a 63-year-old Scottish Presbyterian, Ewan McCaskill, to Hong Kong, who spent a long time with Snowden. And Ewan, I'll say, a real obvious example of the Fourth Estate, former chief political correspondent, everything else, came back and he said, as far as I'm concerned, this man is utterly, utterly genuine. He's thought this thing through and he knows how he wants this release to happen. And so the story started. And the first story we did was about Verizon on June the 6th. And we were able to do that story by negotiating with the American authorities. By negotiating. There's no prior restraint. The legal threats you work under the Espionage Act there. So we were able to talk to the White House. We were able to talk to the NSA. We were able to talk to the Department of Justice. And they really engaged. They tried to stop us publishing it. In fact, that one night I took a call from the deputy chief of the FBI who said, please don't do this. We're not telling you not to do it, but please don't do it at the moment. Give us a few days. Completely different approach in Britain, of course, where there was a D notice standing and we were very, very worried about the prior restraint under either confidence or the Official Secrets Act. So we started doing these stories. And when we did several stories, we did a story about GCHQ and there was an emergency debate in the House where William Hague was fantastically skilled at obfuscating the entire issue, but he did it very eloquently. And we then did a story which seemed to have nettled the government more than anyone else. And that was when we did the stories about how British intelligence agencies bugged two London conferences. And lo and behold, we bugged our allies, the Turks, we bugged our allies, the South Africans, we set up false internet cafes, we did directional mic stuff, so on and so forth. And this was the thing that really got the government's dandruff, as it were. So we then started they sort of approached us, we then started talking to the government, and then we had two off-the-record meetings. And it subsequently came out, we didn't name him, but we had a meeting with the cabinet secretary, who was incredibly polite, but very, very direct. It's our stuff, we want it back, you've had your debate. In fact, at one point he said, you've had your fun, now give us it back. And we said, no, we're not gonna do that. We can't give you back because we wanna carry on reporting. And he said, well, I'm afraid, you know, this is it, we want it back now. He talked to us in rather strange terms at some points. He said, how many Chinese agents have you got on the staff? Of course, the wrong answer would say, well, of course, we haven't got any, because then he says, well, what are your vetting procedures like? I mean, it was a sort of a very, very strange conversation in that way. So we carried on with the stories. We'd done PRISM, we'd done Tempora. We were at one point able to talk to a senior, a person who's got a job title, but insisted on being called a senior source with knowledge of intelligence. Which probably accounts for quite a number of people in Britain, actually. But anyway, this a senior source with knowledge of intelligence gave us the contrary view. And we thought, well, we're getting somewhere here now. We're able to talk and engage in the same way as we're able to talk and engage in America. But to be quite honest, they then came in again and they said, well, this is it. I'm afraid you have to now stop. I said, you've had your debate. And we said, well, we haven't had a debate because we believe the Dinos has chilled that debate. The BBC hasn't done anything on this, for instance. William Hague was on for 14 minutes or something on the much-vaunted 10 past 8 slot on the Today programme, wasn't even asked about it, so on and so forth. Anyway, that didn't seem to be the issue. So they said, right, legal action is a very, very real possibility here. You know, it's active. And legal action to us, I can't talk about, we can't talk about the legal advice we had, but there was the very real possibility, perhaps probability, that legal action against us, whether it be done under confidence or the Official Secrets Act, would have meant the closing down of all the reporting. And we had sort of three or four aims. Number one was to protect Snowden, because we didn't want any of the evidence coming out and then being used against Snowden in later court cases. Number two, we wanted to protect our own reporters, because the government said they wanted the material back and they wanted to do forensics on it and trace its journey. So we didn't want the activities of our reporters within this cache being open to scrutiny like that. But number three, and the main thing really, was to carry on reporting. So there was then a sort of an out in the negotiations, and the personnel changed, and this was all sort of behind the scenes. The negotiations changed, and the out was that we have confidence that you've destroyed it. So there, we then went into the most surreal 36 hours I've certainly had as a journalist, and I've worked on The Guardian more than 25 years, whereby we agreed with two men from GCHQ, who were terribly nice, terribly polite. The government had told us they were waiting around the corner in a white van. Whether that was true or not, I don't know. But the two blokes from GCHQ came in, and they gave a list of things that we had to do to say that the material had been destroyed. And they said, well, we'll do it. And I said, no, we'll go out and buy this stuff. So we went out and bought angle grinders and Dremels. If you're good at DIY, you'll know what this stuff is. Angle grinders, Dremels. We bought masks. We bought, because this stuff is quite dangerous when you're doing it. It creates a lot of smoke and everything. We found a room in the basement, a concrete room. Got the sprinklers turned off, because otherwise they would have gone off. And on Saturday, July the 20th, the two chaps from GCHQ came with us, and we got the computers, which had been entirely new computers. They'd been in a room that was completely sealed. They were off the system, so on and so forth. We had an incredibly complicated system of protecting this material, because we didn't want to cause inadvertent damage or anything like that. And so we set about destroying the material, and they took photographs, and we angle ground the stuff, and then they said, we'll take it away, and we said, no, we need to keep it. And they said, okay, shook hands, and off they went. And in a sense, that was bizarre, because they knew fully well, because we told them 2 weeks earlier, that this material was sitting in New York with our American partners. They didn't know who the partners were then, but the following Monday they knew it was the New York Times and ProPublica. And so it was entirely symbolic. And we were completely puzzled. Well, we went through this because it seemed to be the right thing to do, and it was the only way of carrying on the reporting. But as I say, it was an entirely symbolic, bizarre sort of moment that seemed to satisfy a certain desire within them for something action, so that somebody could go back and say to somebody else, we've closed this part of the operation down. And to be quite honest, it sort of emphasises and illustrates how at heart, GCHQ and the British government don't believe a word of any of these stories should have ever been written. And that remains there. That remains their case to the day, that they don't believe there should be, they believe there's been a debate, but they don't believe we should have written any of these stories. And we're incredibly frustrated that we see the debate going on in America, we see the debate in Germany, we see the debate in Finland and Denmark, and we see some of the debate in France, and we see a huge debate in Brazil and Mexico. And here, apart from, with thanks to Tom and some others brave enough to talk about this, there's very little debate. And so we find ourselves 300 stories on. We've done 300 stories of this, some of them ancillary stories, some of them big stories. 300 stories on. We're seeing a bill possibly coming into Congress. We're seeing action there, so on and so forth. And here, we are the subject of a criminal inquiry. So our journalism, there's a process going on at the moment which could end up with the journalism that we've done being criminalised. So you can see how frustrated, annoyed, but on the other hand, how determined we are as well.
Would you like to see something like the First Amendment brought into British law?
We had a conversation with somebody close to government who's quite influential in these matters, who said, when we said, look, if there was a First Amendment and there was no prior restraint in that sense, what a better setup would it be? And this person said, I think you'll find that wouldn't work for us. A gentleman's agreement works much better in British society.
This is what I've always said, that this is a country that is governed by gentlemen's agreement, and that worked as long as everybody who was interested in governing the country were gentlemen. I think we were going to go to Nick next. Nick is the executive director of Big Brother Watch, which is a campaigning organization on privacy issues.
Less than a year ago, Parliament was debating and scrutinizing draft legislation relating solely to the access of information about internet communications. And we were told there was a capability gap. Senior civil servants gave evidence to Parliament stating how this capability gap was causing problems, how the internet was the Wild West, how we couldn't get information.
I think now, the NSA has been calling that going dark.
Well, and the interesting thing that we now have to ask is, firstly, how did Parliament fail so spectacularly to get genuine answers to those questions, given what we now know has happened? And I spoke at an event last night with David Blunkett and Helen Goodman, and one of the things that I said is, we have a cultural problem in Britain about people being incredibly trusting of the intelligence agencies, but also from a political point of view, and Paul's absolutely right, there are not many parliamentarians who are willing to stand up and say it, but perhaps sometimes the spooks might get it wrong. Not all the time, they're all good people, they work very hard, but perhaps sometimes they make mistakes. And yet it seems in Parliament, saying that is tantamount to calling them all traitors. And I think that's a very dangerous chilling effect we currently have. So where do we start in terms of legal reforms is something that I hope Parliament will discuss, particularly leading up to the next election. And the first point that I always come back to is the governing laws of surveillance, particularly the Regulation of Investigatory Powers Act and the Intelligence Services Act, were both written before the internet was pervasive. One was written before the internet barely existed, the other when less than 10% of people had internet access. And so we have a situation where GCHQ are using a provision on fibre optic cables leaving the UK called external communications, which was written for copper phone cable. The idea that someone rang somebody in another country and it was a single connection, versus now, that same power being used to stream billions of pieces of information from fibre optic cables carrying huge amounts of data about our lives, to the basic point that two people sat next to each other at a table having a Facebook chat conversation are now deemed to be outside the legal framework for interception because that communication might be routed through California. So as a starting point, it's pretty clear, and David Blunkett agreed with this point last night, that the law we have in place governing how the intelligence agencies gather data is not fit for an internet age. The principles are there, but the wording isn't strong enough to ensure that it doesn't mean this broad interpretation. The second point, and again, David Blunkett agreed with this last night, was the fact that the British oversight mechanisms are run largely by gentlemen's agreements, or more commonly, by political decision. So to intercept a phone call in World War II, a piece of paper would land on the Home Secretary or the Minister of War's desk. In 2013, we don't have a Minister of War, but it's still the Home Secretary's desk it lands on. And the fact that we are a modern liberal democracy who aspires that we have the mother of all parliaments, and yet it is still a political appointee who is solely responsible for making the decision about intercepting communications, without any opportunity for redress, without any independent oversight, and the only regulatory intervention is after the fact and providing the person who has been intercepted finds out about it and can then complain. Now, when we stand up at cybersecurity conferences or human rights conferences or trade conferences and we say to developing democracies, human rights and rights for businesses to do their business securely are a basic part of your democracy, we are doing the right thing. We are spreading our values that make our country great. The problem is, it seems that we've been telling the world to do one thing while doing something entirely different ourselves. So what do we now say when Saudi Arabia or Egypt or Indonesia or Brazil say, actually, we are going to have our own mini internet and we are going to control what our citizens see? And we are going to watch everything they do, because that's just what Britain does. Mm-hmm. And we're going to call it public safety for the benefit of the children and for national security, and we're just doing what Britain does. So having been a country that has tried to spread democracy, we've now become the excuse and the justification for countries around the world to pursue their own version of totalitarian government. The difference is we have people in suits saying it's okay. So I think we have to go right back to the beginning and say, where should our legal framework be in the 21st century? To me, the starting point is transparency. The fact that in the US, we're now talking about the government publishing the number of American citizens who are engaged by national security letters. And yet in Britain, when Big Brother Watch and other groups asked the independent overseer, how many cases did you look at last year to justify that you think the system is working? And we were told that's a national security secret. Just to know how many authorizations he'd read to check the system. And the Americans are now talking about having adversarial court processes. The Americans are now talking about public hearings with all their senior intelligence people. You have a situation where the Director of National Intelligence gives evidence to Congress. And yet in Britain, it was such a surprise that someone from GCHQ would speak publicly that the parliamentary committee responsible put a press release out saying, Hail Mary, the day has come. Someone is emerging from the shadows. So we have this situation, ridiculously, where our intelligence agencies still have the mindset of not even the Cold War. It's probably World War II, when we still had MI9. And we need to bring this whole framework into the 21st century based on principles of we have policing by consent, and surveillance works the same way. And you cannot hold these things in secret and say to people, trust us. Because time and time again through our history and the history of other countries, that trust has been betrayed. If you go back to the Mau Mau, the British Attorney General at the time wrote a letter to the British government and said, I've uncovered evidence of torture by British authorities in the territory. But if we're going to sin, we must sin quietly. And it seems that that principle is still at the heart of much of the officialdom responsible for this. So Parliament needs to drag them into the open. And where secrecy is justified to protect operations, that is right, but secrecy cannot be justified to simply protect the embarrassment or even just the little empires that have been built up. And then I think we will have the debate. But I think the problem we have now is that we do not simply know what is going on, even down to a basic level of what the police do versus what the intelligence agencies do. And that's why I think the debate hasn't started in this country. So for me personally, the transparency agenda is one which civil society needs to take forward with real vigor. And then we will start having the debate.
I always thought that if Watergate had happened here, no one would have ever found out about it. That was one time I was actually quite proud of the U.S., was that, you know, they had these hearings and they had them broadcast live and anybody could watch. I thought that was very impressive.
Let me just start by recapping. I mean, I think we've gone straight into the issue, but just so we understand what we are talking about, I mean, the transnational mass surveillance system that we are discussing involves the UK government recording every single bit of information that leaves the country in and out for 3 days, 3 days of information. That is around 200 times the contents of the British Library every day, every 24 hours. And we are talking about vast amounts. Everything we do is now being recorded for 3 days, sift through metadata, which is what is called the who and what and when, kept for 30 days. I mean, we are not talking about a few, you know, cables here and there. This is what completely unprecedented. You know, what many people thought that the security services would never be able to catch up with the power of the internet and the growth of computers and data centers, well, we were all wrong. You know, actually, they have been able to catch up, and we haven't been able to catch up with them at the moment. I mean, we are struggling, as Paul said. So for us, the two questions here is, like, what are the implications of this, as I said, you know, unprecedented? It should be shocking, you know, it should be front page of every paper. Unfortunately, it's not yet, you know, a situation that we have. From a democracy point of view, I mean, I don't think we can say that we are in a police state yet, but I mean, really, we are, I mean, it's not scaremongering. We are heading to a really bad place, and we can see examples of those bad places in the news every day. You know, freedom of expression, you know, definitely these things will have an impact when everyone understands, you know, that everything you do is recorded and monitored. The US laws that allow these things to happen expressly allow monitoring of political activities as long as they don't involve US persons. So we are not talking about, you know, a hypothetical case. I mean, these things happen. We have evidence from European Union reports from 2001 that the US was actually involved in economic espionage at the time of the Echelon. So again, we are not talking about hypothetical cases, and we've seen some reports of actually spying on Brazilian oil companies, you know, and possibly in other partners. So these are really, really serious matters. I mean, we look at freedom of association. I mean, the software that the security services are using maps relationships automatically. I mean, how many people are going to find themselves, you know, on the wrong side of the law because they are friend of a friend? You know, you have 2 degrees of separation to someone that is Muslim and is involved in something potentially. These things, I mean, that's the kind of danger that we are facing, including the danger of automatic profiling. I mean, this information generated through this system is not just sitting there, you know, waiting for someone. It's actually used for targeting further investigation. So, I mean, they actually, in one of the reports, they talk about anomalous events. So if something in your file triggers an anomalous event, you will be pinpointed for further investigation. I mean, we don't know how many drone attacks, you know, have been generated directly from, you know, the involvement of this type of intelligence in drone attacks. But, I mean, we are not just talking about a knock on the door. I mean, this is quite serious stuff. So all these things, I mean, basically, this is a fundamental attack, as we see it, on our concept of democracy. This idea that, you know, security services are running a completely, well, not complete, but at some point unaccountable or ineffectively accounted for system. We think that we really need to have this type of debate, you know, as in, you know, we cannot say it strongly enough. You know, we support what Nick and everyone is saying. But we also think that there is a very important aspect, which is the economic aspect of the leaks. I mean, the latest, some of the latest revelations in The Guardian involve the program called Bull Run, which is basically a 10-year-long program from the National Security Agency and the GCHQ to break fundamental security and encryption on the internet. And again, this might seem like an arcane, you know, issue for geeks that you shouldn't care about until you realize that you use it every time you pay on the internet. Every time you check your bank, every time you do anything that you consider is secure information online, you are relying on these technologies. And now we know that the US and the British government have spent the best part of the last 10 years trying to undermine this system. And the worst thing is that they haven't done it by being really clever and finding a mathematical whiz kid that is going to break the encryption. What they've done is actually something a lot worse. They've weakened the protocols, they've weakened the international standards, they've infiltrated people in the international standard bodies that set up the protocols for these things to work, to undermine and basically weaken the processes around the mathematics and the encryption. And the problem is that there is no way that we can know that only the US and the UK governments are benefiting from this. I mean, you are destroying the security of the internet with what you're doing. And this, the whole international technical community that works in security has spent the last month, you know, reviewing every single bit of internet computer security that we all rely on every day for our banking, for our economics. And the UK is in a particularly important and vulnerable position. I mean, the UK is a world leader on e-commerce. You know, we do more, you know, online shopping than similar nations, both in Europe and even more than the US per, you know, when you look at individuals. And that relies not just on having a good Royal Mail, maybe not for long, but, you know, but it relies on these type of technologies. And, you know, again, like, we cannot stress, you know, how problematic these revelations are. You know, I know many people here come from the web tech community, you know, apart from the Labour Party, and, you know, you will understand, you know, what we are talking about. This is really, really serious. And we think that is so highly irresponsible, you know, to undermine the internet just on the basis that if it's my toy, if I cannot play with it, I'll just break it for everyone. And this is what the National Security Agency and GCHQ are doing with the internet as we know it right now. So, of course, you know, let's, you know, I mean, if you talk about cloud computing and people using email addresses from the US, I mean, the whole story is now completely up in arms. The European Union is considering quite seriously whether European companies should use this type of services, you know, if they want to claim that they are secure. So, what we'd like to see, again, you know, it's just very clear, you know, we want to see a national debate. You know, we want other newspapers than The Guardian, you know, to start publishing more stories. You know, we want political parties like Labour, you know, to start taking these issues seriously. And as we, as Wendy asked, you know, this is not just going to work at the national level. I mean, we are seeing that the US, very importantly, you know, they've been leaning on this. The UK has got a huge responsibility and it's failed to protect UK citizens, but also, you know, citizens from other countries. I mean, and the UK really has a lot to answer here. I mean, when the Brazilian government or the German government and German citizens, you know, we know now that 500 German bits of information or bits of information coming in and out from Germany had been recorded and spied on. I mean, the UK has a lot to answer, and this is really weakening our relationships with European partners, you know, and it's basically really bad news. So what we think we need is a reform of UK laws, but what we need is a more international agreement, and their civil society has developed what we call the international principles for on the application of human rights to communication surveillance, which we believe, you know, that should be the guiding principles for developing law in the UK, but also elsewhere. And the starting points that surveillance should be legal, should be necessary, adequate, should be proportionate, you know, is the to the you know to suspicion of a crime, and very importantly, yes, should be transparency, a level of as much transparency as possible, and there should be some level of independent judicial oversight, which is one of the things that we know now that the UK is preaching elsewhere, but it definitely lacks at home. So those are the kind of things we want to see from Labour, and but we also think that this is not just the responsibility of political parties. I mean, we need a grassroots movement, both a grassroots movement within Labour, and we need like normal citizens to start asking these questions from their representatives, you know, and from each other. You know, is this the kind of society we want to live in? And someone said before, for the techies here in the community, I mean, I think that now we cannot just say, well, we'll solve it through technology. You know, there are all these spying keys, so I'm just going to encrypt all my emails, use the virtual private networks, I'm just going to throw the whole armory of technology at this, and I'm going to survive and hide in a mountain in the Rockies or something. This is just not going to work. Basically, I mean, with the NSA, and even if it works for one, it's never going to work for all of us. You know, so I think we really need to look at a political solution. You know, and a political solution that involves, say, citizens, government, and also private companies. I mean, I can see some people from businesses here. You know, and I think that, you know, private businesses, particularly internet companies, you know, really need to start taking some responsibility. They've made a lot of noise in the U.S. We still have to hear Google, Microsoft, Facebook, you know, making the same noises in the UK, you know, so we expect to see that as well.
I think, you know, one of the things that you said, that international cooperation is really important. Mm-hmm. I think that's true because, you know, it used to be that you knew when you were visiting mm-hmm. a foreign country, yeah. and if you didn't like that foreign country's policies, you could decide not to go there. But until, you know, Facebook and Google and everybody start putting up giant American flags saying, entering the United States now, you know, on the internet, the whole point was to make it seamless so you couldn't actually tell where you were. And that turns out to be quite dangerous. The U.S. Second Amendment is much maligned, and correctly so, in my opinion, but one of the points about it is the reason you want an armed populace is to ensure that the government doesn't become too powerful. And when you create something that the police state can use to control you, you know, today's government may be friendly, tomorrow's government may not be, and Tom, who you never know, may be part of a government down the road.
look, what do I want to say? I'm reminded of that Arthur Miller quote. Arthur Miller said, a good newspaper, I suppose, is a nation talking to itself. And I think our starting point tonight should be to thank Paul and The Guardian for what they have done. It's our paper. It's the nation's paper. And it is the only one that I think has raised this issue, which is of great concern to many, many people out there. Not that you would read it in any of the newspapers, and as Paul said, nor see it on our public service broadcasters, which I think is disgraceful. Because what The Guardian have done with these series of stories in putting their faith in the whistleblower Edward Snowden is expose the explosive growth in the power of the surveillance state. And, you know, I was a little bit naive when I first entered Parliament in 2001. I look at Nick there, by the way. Nick, you might not know this, but he hopes to be a Conservative MP one day. And he's just given you a very articulate speech, and I agree with every single word he said. And I think that if he ever does get elected to Parliament, he will make a difference to our country with that kind of thinking. But I wouldn't have been that articulate when I was a candidate in 2001, and I didn't know a lot of this stuff. But the truth is, 12 years in, I now believe we live in the most closed system of liberal democracy in the Western world. I think we have the most unaccountable intelligence services in most modern democracies. And I think parliamentary scrutiny has failed. It's not just failed, it doesn't exist for most of the work of some of our intelligence services. And it took our paper, the Guardian newspaper, to make that the absolute truth. It is now undeniable that that is the situation. And the system we have of close scrutiny, as they call it, chaired by Sir Malcolm Rifkin, I just have no faith in it at all. And Parliament's got to take, I hope that parliamentarians on all sides of the House can unite to say we're not going to do this anymore. We're not going to accept this. And, you know, but you wouldn't think, I know, if it sounds unusual for an MP to say this in this country, because there's not really any conversation going on at the parliamentary level about it, is it? But just look around the world, some people have alluded to it tonight. The president of Brazil cancelled a state visit to Washington to meet the president of the United States. How often does that happen? I don't think it's ever happened in my parliamentary career. The German justice minister called this whole episode a Hollywood nightmare. The EU is considering reviewing its safe harbour protections for data held in other jurisdictions. We found out through the pages of The Guardian that GCHQ hacked into Belgium Telecom, which might have given them the access to European Parliament and the European Commission. Al Gore said that Edward Snowden was courageous, and even John McCain has said that it's entirely appropriate that Congress reviews what the NSA have got up to. Can you think about what any important leader in the United Kingdom Parliament has said about this? Because I can't. I can't pull out any quote at all from the top of my head. And when you think of it like that, don't you think it is an absolute disgrace that we're actually putting up with it? That people in this country are allowing our parliament to have such a callous denial to an issue of such major importance to our civil liberties and the future freedoms of our children? Because I think it is absolutely unacceptable. And I'm just going to end there because I know we'll open this up. It's something I'm going to pick up in Parliament, and there are other MPs in other parties that are hoping to stimulate some backbench debates at least. Dr. Julian Hubbard from the Lib Dems is one of the leading lights. So we've got sort of cross-party support. But the editor of my paper, The Guardian, Alan Rusbridger, some of you might know him, some of you won't. He's not a man with the reputation for using hyperbole. He's quite a humble man, really. He says he's a man of very few words. But even today, he says in a column, the potential of the surveillance state goes way beyond anything in George Orwell's 1984. And if Alan Rusbridger says that, then we should all be concerned. And I hope that one thing we can take away from tonight is we're not going to put up with it. And we build a cross-party coalition to try and make our intelligence services accountable once and for all, and to try and put some form of democratic oversight into what has been a totally, the surveillance state running amok, and we can't let it continue this way.